Thank you very much for that incredibly kind introduction. I will stop blushing soon. Honourable Madam Vice-Chancellor, distinguished fellow speakers, Professor Chauhan, Baroness Amos, students and faculty of Presidency University, namaskar and good morning to you all. I was delighted when Madam VC and the Director of SOAS, University of London, agreed that our two universities, which are each unique in their own ways, should forge a partnership to mark the beginning of their third and second centuries, respectively. And I was very honored to be invited to deliver this lecture on the highly auspicious occasion of the of Presidency University's bicentenary. I studied for my undergraduate and postgraduate degrees at the School of Oriental and African Studies, which we now call SOAS, University of London, and I returned there as a research fellow in 1987, never to leave again. So I've called SOAS home in one way or another for a total of 38 of its 100 years. To mark its centenary, SOAS formulated a list of questions worth asking, to which it claimed it was best placed to offer the answers. The first of these questions was, should we all speak the same language? And I have taken this question as the cue for my lecture today. So during my lecture, I will pose and attempt to answer two questions. First, is it possible that one day all human beings will speak the same language? And secondly, what might we lose, what might be lost if they did? Let me begin by considering the first of these. And obviously, the first thing to say is that, yes, languages have been dying out at an ever-accelerating rate over the past two or three centuries. And so it might be supposed that, yes, we are moving towards a situation where we're all going to speak the same language. So let us see where things currently stand. This slide lists the languages that claim the highest number of mother tongue speakers in the world, drawn from the well-known resource Ethnologue. Unsurprisingly, Chinese, Spanish, English, Arabic, and Hindi top the list. Of course, this does not record the number of actual number of speakers of these languages worldwide. For instance, over a billion people speak English in addition to a language they regard as their first, making it the most widely spoken language on Earth. On the other hand, of course, an increasing number of people all over the world are studying Chinese these days. So the pole position of English as the world's favorite language is not necessarily assured in the longer term. This slide sets out the world's linguistic complexity and focuses on the sheer number of languages spoken in the world today, a total, according to the usual sort of conventional wisdom, of around 7,105. Of these, European languages constitute only 4%, with Asia-Pacific offering over 50% and Africa over 30%. This slide sets out these statistics in the form of a pie chart for those of us who find pie charts more illuminating. And this demonstrates that over 60% of the world's languages are spoken in Asia and Africa, the regions of the world covered by SOAS's teaching and research. And the next slide shows the global distribution of languages, particular focus on the languages spoken in Asia, Africa, Southeast Asia, and the Pacific. And finally, some examples of countries that are particularly linguistically complex, either because they have a very large number of indigenous languages, Papua New Guinea, for instance, or because they have benefited from the arrival of immigrants from elsewhere, the UK being the case shown here. However, as this slide demonstrates, a huge proportion of the world's population speaks just 100 of the world's 7,000 odd languages. The rest are spoken by very small numbers of people, just 10% of the world's population. Moreover, 94% of the world's languages are spoken by just 6% of the world's population, and between 50 and 90% of the world's languages are classified as endangered. This means that they will almost certainly cease being spoken at all within the next few decades, either because their speakers are dying out or because they are shifting to speaking other languages. Endangered languages, as they are called, tend to be spoken in regions of high linguistic diversity where a national or state-sponsored language is gaining ascendancy. English and Spanish, for instance, in the Americas and Australia. Swahili in East Africa. Hindi and Bengali in Northeast India, just to take a few cases in point. Now, this screen grab from the BBC website in 2009 has a very alarmist deadline, the death of language. Now, the death of language as a phenomenon is, of course, unthinkable. We will always need languages. And in fact, I think it's more likely that, in fact, that the process of languages dying out will eventually reach some kind of end point. Maybe that will come sometime before the list of human languages has been boiled down to, say, 15 or 20 languages. If you want to see an arrogant British monolingualist turn pale, just point out to them that if the world was going to decide tomorrow to adopt a single language on the basis of a majority vote by mother tongue speakers, we would all of us have to learn Chinese. I also think there are good reasons for hoping that this process of linguistic homogenization reaches an end point sooner rather than later. This is because I believe that human understanding and empathy, which are the only things that are going to get us through the crises that loom over our species, will not emerge from cultural and linguistic uniformity. Of course, globalization is bringing us all closer together as, depending on your ideological perspective, fellow victims or fellow beneficiaries of market forces. The need for much more intense and effective communication across the world is inevitably forcing us to use a dwindling number of languages. However, the process of globalization does not seem to be building a global village or reinforcing feelings of human solidarity, at least not in the part of the world where I live. Instead, it seems to be provoking a return to claims of particularism and national specialness, to a new set of barriers and divisions. So let me turn now to my second question. What would humanity lose if we all ended up speaking the same language? I must emphasize that my answers to this question are not those of a trained theoretical linguist. They are merely the unsophisticated opinions of an individual who has taught and studied languages, principally Hindi and Nepali, and attempted to use them to the maximum extent possible in his research into literature, culture, and sometimes also politics. Now, about a third of the world's languages are in danger of disappearing within the next generation, together with their associated linguistic, cultural and social practices. The discipline of documentary linguistics has developed to provide a record of the world's linguistic heritage and to help support revitalization efforts. And SOAS's research is at the center of this, providing training, research, and outreach. The Endangered Languages Project, established at SOAS in 2001 and funded by Arcadia, trains linguists to go out and record endangered languages and create a lasting record of them. It has to date funded and supported 351 documentation projects around the world, which are all shown on this map from its website. Its archive now contains documentation of nearly 400 languages, including grammatical studies, dictionaries, over 8,000 hours of audio recordings, and over 900 hours of video recordings. Dr. Mandana Seifidinipur, the director of the Endangered Languages Project at SOAS, is very familiar with members of the public criticizing her project. See, they often suppose that it's somehow trying to prop up a kind of unsustainable global babel, which they see as an obstacle to the growth of global communication and understanding. Her favorite ripostes to these objections are, firstly, to point out that at any given time, the majority of the world's wars are civil wars between groups of people who are perfectly capable of understanding each other's languages if only they would learn to listen to one another. She secondly often asks her challengers whether they are married, and if so, whether their spouse speaks the same language as them, and whether this means they never disagree about anything. In fact, I think the objection to the scholarly efforts to record and document endangered languages before they disappear comes from a perspective on language that is fundamentally monolingual. As we all know, the majority of the world's population speaks more than one language and grows up doing so. As Holmes observes in his introduction to sociolinguistics, and I quote, "For most of the world, it is bilingualism and multilingualism which is normal." In countries like Zaire or India, the idea that you should stop speaking one language when you start learning another is quite inconceivable, end of quote. I remember the children of a Tibetan family I lived with in Kathmandu in the 1980s. They spoke Tibetan to their parents and relatives at home. They spoke Newari to their neighbors and the local shopkeepers, and Nepali to their school teachers. They watched and understood Hindi films every weekend and studied English at school. Now, would a move to a single global language lead to a loss of culture? Or, to spell this out more clearly, is it important to maintain linguistic diversity in the world because different languages lead their speakers to different thoughts and perceptions, and because losing these languages would lead to a kind of global narrowing of human thought and understanding? In his book, Through the Language Glass, Guy Deutscher writes, and I quote, "For most serious scholars today, the answer to this question is a resounding no. The dominant view among contemporary linguists is that language is primarily an instinct. In other words, that the fundamentals of language, universal grammar, are coded in our DNA and are the same across the human race. Noam Chomsky has famously argued that a Martian scientist would conclude that all Earthlings speak dialects of the same language," end of quote. However, Deutscher constructs a counter-argument to this that I find compelling. He defines culture as all human traits that are not the result of instinct. And he argues that dividing languages into two distinct territories, one called concepts, which are held to be universal, the other called labels, held to be specific to particular languages and cultures, may be a neat division, but it doesn't really match with reality. Because, as he says, culture not only controls the labels, but embarks on incessant raids across the border into what ought to be the birthright of nature. End of quote. Let me illustrate this with an example that I think might resonate in Kolkata. If we all spoke the same language, we would pretty soon have to decide between us what word we were going to use for tea. But if we settled on a single word, which would almost certainly be either a word derived from cha or a word derived from ta, we would lose a living legacy of the history of world trade, colonialism, and linguistic and cultural borrowing. Words spread and are transmitted along with material culture. The example of names for tea demonstrates that languages do not need to be geographically contiguous to each other in order to lend words. And it demonstrates that interactions between languages also mirror historic patterns of world trade and colonialism in this particular example. As you know, the tea plant grows naturally across a vast area from Assam to Vietnam to the east coast of China. And using its leaves to make a beverage is a practice that originated in China and has been dated back to 2700 BCE. It spread first to Japan in about 800 CE, then to Europe about 900 years later. So words for tea differ across the world due to the fact that they came via different routes. Most Sinitic languages have a word similar to Mandarin cha. However, Minnan Chinese spoken in Fujian and Taiwan has forms similar to te. Therefore, many mainland Asian and Central European languages whose speakers obtain their tea via overland routes from Chinese sources other than Fujian and Taiwan use words like cha or chai. These forms also spread to East Africa due to historic migration and cultural and changing and trading interchanges across the Indian Ocean. Interestingly, the Portuguese imported their tea via Macau, with the consequence that while most of Europe now drinks tea, the Portuguese drink cha. And the Dutch traders who first introduced tea to Europe had their main contacts in Fujian province and therefore adopted the word te. As a consequence, languages such as Indonesian, Malay, Javanese, spoken in former Dutch colonies, use the word te. While East Africa uses cha, West and South Africa and most American and European speakers use te or ta forms, which are brought there from Europe. In his 1690 essay concerning human understanding, John Locke recognized that each language organizes its own specific ideas in its own special way, and argued his point with reference to, and I quote, the great store of words in one language which have not any that answer them in another. Which plainly shows that those of one country, by their customs and manner of life, have found occasion to make several complex ideas and given names to them, which others never collected into specific ideas. End of quote. To put it in simpler terms, Roman Jacobson has argued that languages differ essentially in what they must convey and not in what they may convey. And that, to quote him, people find names for the things they feel they need to talk about. The Nigerian writer Chigozie Obiama wrote an interesting article for The Guardian recently in which he discussed what he called provincialism in writing. By this, he means the tendency of some writers, and he's talking about African writers, to defiantly use items of unexplained African vocabulary in the stories, novels, etc. they write and publish in English. And I quote from him here. Suppose the African author wants to write about the Moluwe, the iconic Lagos bus, and simply refers to it mid-sentence. He might praise himself or be praised by defenders of this kind of politicized provincialism for having been brave or authentic. But what does a reader see? Just a bus. There is no doubt that a reader who lives in Lagos might be at an advantage, but if a writer describes it as a beat-up, squeaking, yellow-painted bus with a constant metallic rattle, everyone, including the Lagos reader, will have a clear image of such a bus. Languages of small, illiterate societies typically have vocabularies of 3,000 to 5,000 words. Large dictionaries of major European languages may include 50,000 to 70,000 words. The full printed edition of the Oxford English Dictionary has around 300,000 entries. Of course, many of these words are obsolete, and an average English speaker would recognize only a fraction of them. An average English-speaking university student is reckoned to have a passive vocabulary of probably 40,000 words. These are words he or she will recognize even if they don't actively use them. In illiterate societies, the size of the vocabulary is restricted because there is only a very tiny passive vocabulary at most, and the passive vocabulary of one generation has no way of living on to see the next, because a word that is not actively used by one generation will not be heard by the next generation and will then be lost forever. So what would we lose if no one needed to study languages anymore? There is an expression in English which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. In the course of a discussion or an argument, one English speaker will often say to another, "I understand where you're coming from." This isn't to say that he or she agrees with what the other person is saying. In fact, the statement is almost invariably followed by the word "but." But it conveys a sense that he or she understands why the other person might think as they do and understands the context within which they have formed their judgment. Educated Indians have a pretty good understanding of where the British are coming from. Culturally, intellectually, politically, partly, though not solely, because English is an Indian language too. But educated Britons have a much poorer understanding of where Indians are coming from. And this isn't only because we are just about the most monolingual nation on earth, basking in the false security of the notion that sooner or later everyone's going to end up speaking our language. It's also because historically the British have been used to setting the agenda for the cross-cultural conversation and expecting a large section of the world's population to fall into line with it. But there is a level of understanding between members of different speech communities that can only really emerge if one has made the effort to learn the other's language. This isn't to say that cross-cultural understandings don't emerge from encounters between communities that have different heritages but speak the same languages. Those do emerge. But there is a humility and an honoring of other people that comes with learning their languages, for which there are very few parallels. I find it very difficult to think of anything that would substitute for language learning as a means of saying to a person from another culture, "I wish to understand you. I wish to understand where you are coming from." So every language is a culture, a unique way of being in the world. Every culture has a language, a unique way of seeing and describing the world. Learning another way of being and another way of seeing and describing the world is education in the fullest sense. Without this education, or indeed without even the need for this education, I believe we would be culturally much the poorer. What would we lose if no one needed to translate literature anymore? A Nepali example. In 1936, a young Nepali man named Lakshmi Prasad Devkota published a 44-page narrative poem entitled Muna Madan Kokata, the story of Muna and Madan. This was the tale of a trader from Kathmandu who was lured to Lhasa in Tibet by the promise of gold and musk. He tarried there over long and returned home to find that he had lost everything that was dear to him. Unlike the highbrow classical poetry that had dominated Nepali literature thus far, this poem was written in the musical sing-song meter of a particular genre of folk song, and it imparted many social and moral lessons. It remains the best-loved and most widely read text in the Nepali language even today, and for this reason, many people have tried to translate it into English and have had to make difficult choices along the way about what to retain and what to discard of the original Nepali poem's music, rhyme, and meter. The most famous lines of the poem are as follows. Hataka maila sunaka tela ke garnu dhanale sagara sisnu kayaku bes anandi manale, which means Hataka maila, the dirt of the hands. Sunaka tela, small purses or bags of gold. Ke garnu, kya kare in Hindi, what to do. With wealth, or by wealth, or through wealth. Sagara sishnu, greens and nettles. Kayako, eating or having eaten. Bes, better. Anandi manale, with a happy, anandi heart or mind, man. One translator has tried to retain the rhythm and rhyme of these lines. Dirt of the hands, a bag of gold. What use is it in kind? It's better to eat nettles and greens with a peace of mind. A second expanded them greatly in order to ensure that the imagined foreign reader would understand all their references thoroughly. Riches. What does riches avail? Riches are also vain. They are no better than a crust of dirt that cling on to thy hand. Is not a dish of nettles made far more a delicious thing? Such a dish the richer we find when we eat it with contented mind. In my own translation, published in 1996, I attempted to find a compromise between the two, and I'll leave you to judge whether I succeeded. Bags of gold are like the dirt on your hands. What can be done with wealth? Better to eat only nettles and greens with happiness in your heart. But frankly, I think there is really only one way of expressing these sentiments with the required force of meaning and musicality, and that is as follows. Hataka maila sunaka tela kegarnu dhanale sagara sisnu kayaku bes anandi manale. I hope you will forgive me if I end by offering you a small fragment of autobiography. On the 27th of December 1977, at the age of 20, I boarded an Air India flight from London to Delhi. I'd never left the UK before. I'd never flown in an aeroplane. I was off to spend 4 months in this country to improve my rudimentary Hindi and understand, my professors thought, both literally and metaphorically, where Hindi speakers were coming from. This formative experience set a course for me along which I am still traveling. And my journey has been enriched by the fact that people I've attempted to study, explain, and understand speak languages other than my own. This is why it's very important for me, on a personal and professional level, that we continue to teach and study and learn languages at SOAS in Asian and African languages, and not just the big four that attract lots and lots of students to cover the costs of teaching them, but also languages such as Hausa, Turkish, Thai, and yes, Bengali, that require subsidies and philanthropic support to keep them going. So we're deeply grateful to Presidency for entering into this partnership with us, and also to the West Bengal government for funding Vishwa Bangla scholarships, which will enable students from West Bengal to study with us in London. For all the reasons I've discussed in this lecture, we look forward to a future characterized by continued cultural and linguistic diversity on the one hand, and a growing intensity of communication and comprehension on the other. We all need to know not only where we and our fellow residents of this planet are coming from, but also where we are going. If we all spoke the same language, we would not necessarily understand or appreciate one another any better than we currently do. So learning one another's languages is the key to our journey. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Michael. Questions? We have time for two burning questions. One burning question. That lady in front of you.
Introduce
yourself.
Okay, so I'm Munabi, and I'm an undergraduate student in physics in this university. So I had a comment and a question. The comment, you said that in the slide map you showed that the major words for T in various languages of the world can be divided into either cha or ta. And in Bengali, we often rhyme words while we speak. And we always say, while we are talking about tea, we always say, ekto cha ta hobe. Can we get some, while we say tea, we say, ekto cha ta hobe. Always say ta. So that's what I thought. Also, the question I have is that when you showed that map, there were red points which showed the cha words, and the blue points that show the ta words. There were also some gray points. You didn't point out what those gray points were.
I really hoped you weren't going to ask me that, because that's a slide that was given to me by my colleague from linguistics, and I kept meaning to ask him what the gray points were, and I didn't, so I don't know. I assume that what they are is words for tea that are neither cha or ta, because one assumes, although I don't quite know how that would have happened, in the sense that all the tea has spread across the world from a particular origin. So indigenous American languages, for instance, are unlikely to have had their own words for tea, because tea would not have reached them before the languages that had the words for tea. So it's a mystery to me too, and I apologize for not having an answer to that question. I will go away and find out, and I will email your VC, and she will pass it on to you.
Michael, I think Bengal tops the passion for tea. So any word or symbol you utter for tea, whether it is cha, ta, you make sure, I am sure it will be in Bengali. The cha and the ta and whatever else, any other language says about tea, it's ours.
As I said, it was a topic that would resonate in Calcutta, and here it is resonating, yes.
Second question, yes, you'll identify Madam. Yourself.
So I'm a third year undergraduate student from the Department of Physics. So my question is that you said that should we speak the same language, but my question is that can we speak the same language? Because now, previously it was like the geographical distribution laid the foundations for the different languages, but now with the evolution of the internet and also flight, the geographical distribution has been hampered, but we can actually see that there is a linguistic distribution in between fields. Like, for instance, a person who is into botany will be speaking more of Latin words, while a person into physics will be speaking more of Greek words. Can you please comment on
that? Well, that's the use of vocabulary and terminology rather than the use of a language, isn't it? Because they're not speaking Latin, they're not speaking Greek. They are using terms from those languages, which I would say, I mean, the international language, I would think, Professor Chauhan, I think, is not here, but he would perhaps confirm, is English. But this is terminology that has been brought into that language from other sources. So there are international languages that are discipline specific, as you're suggesting too. particularly in terms of terminology. Is that the point you're making? Yeah, I would strongly agree. But they're not. That is not a language in quite the same way. It's not an entire mode of communication. It's a vocabulary. It's a technical vocabulary that draws from specific languages for that purpose.
Thank you very much. Okay, one last question. It's not on. We can't hear you.
Yes, I'm B.K. Berry, retired mathematics professor. Do you make a distinction between depth of a language on the one hand and its merger into another language on the other?
What was the first kind of language?
The depth of a language and its merger into another language. Moreover, or is it always some kind of merger? Hmm. And moreover, there is this case of Sanskrit. So which has shrunk, it's far from endangered. The activity is limited, but it's far from endangered. So the case of Sanskrit and many other languages would be different.
Mm-hmm. Well, the process of a language dying takes different forms. I mean, one of the projects that I was hearing about from a colleague at SOAS a few years ago was. She was studying a language, a Siberian language, spoken by 10 people. 10 people. So, and they were not passing, the next generation of that community was not speaking that language at all. These were elderly people. So this language was going to actually literally disappear unless some record was made of it in terms of vocabulary lists and grammar and so on. And I would suspect that when a language like that disappears in terms of its full use by an individual or a community of individuals, there would be some vestiges remaining in terms of perhaps vocabulary or expressions and so on that were taken into whatever language had displaced it. So there's also the phenomenon of code switching in the sense that, I mean, a lot of Indians who speak Hindi or Bengali use a very large number of English words in those. And I suppose the question then arises, how much merging can a language survive until it is no longer that same language? We had another project recently at SOAS on Hinglish, which some people think of as being simply Hindi with lots of English vocabulary in it, but the sort of premise of the research was that actually Hinglish had emerged as a distinct language in its own right, at least in sort of common usage. It didn't have a literature per se, but it was on a spoken level. A new kind of hybrid language had emerged, which you couldn't really use unless you knew Hindi grammar, but wasn't really Hindi anymore. So merging, you know, historically has happened many, many, many times and produced new languages from hybrid forms. Sanskrit is the mother of all the Indo-Aryan languages of North India, as you know. So in the same way that Latin and Greek have that same kind of fundamental relationship with European languages. So Sanskrit will never die out, but it may no longer be a language that is spoken in a natural sense, but only in the context of scholarship, I suppose. My thoughts.